Hey, guys, let's give a special thanks to Tonks. Yeah, you heard me. Tonks, our sponsor for today's episode. Tonks is a small company made up of a tight-knit team of experts who believe that everyone deserves a great cup of coffee. And everyone can brew a great cup right in their damn kitchen. If they have the right beans. Tonks sources their beans directly from the growers, roasts them, and ships them directly to you 24 hours after roasting the freshest beans you can find. Sign up with Tonks today. Get a free sample using the URL tonks.org/pollock for a free sample of the best damn coffee in the world. Chat show. I am, as always, chat show. The buffering gag doesn't work if I can't see the screen.
Right.
So the fact that Josh keeps dumping out on the screen in here, is that a problem?
No, you're good. It's going out.
It's going out fine out there.
Can we get the volume up on Josh?
Can you turn up your volume in here? Kenny, you probably control it behind you on the speaker there. March of 2014 will be our five-year anniversary. That puts us at, what, 4.5 years down the barrel there?
We're a little over 4.5, yeah.
Yeah. 4.5. And our motto originally was?
We're not ready.
And it is today?
We are not ready.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll never be ready.
It's nice to be consistent.
Have we ever had a show where nothing went with it went off without a hitch? Like
no. What would be the point of that?
No.
This is show 185. We'll couldn't be prouder of our team and everyone who puts it together. I guess we should probably thank Cal Canis, the evil overlord who houses this very building and production studio, who we never make a point of thanking, nor should we. We've missed you. We've been away for a couple of weeks. What the hell, Sam?
I think we've been away for 2 weeks.
Yes.
Maybe
yeah.
Three?
Two.
Two.
Feels
okay.
Like four.
Well, it's not like we took a holiday break.
No.
That's
no,
like 6 weeks.
There was no holiday.
Yeah.
Sammy, you were just in our nation's capital. Was everything shut down there in the entire D.C. area? Or
is everything is shut down.
Yeah.
There's no food service.
No,
there's
nothing.
There's no street cleaning.
How'd you get in from the airport?
Stoplights were not working.
Chaos.
It's utter chaos in the nation's capital.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know I was there doing some comedy shows with our pal Doug Benson and Tig Notaro.
Mm-hmm.
And it was tremendous fun. Wonderful crowds, good people.
And you did a little stand-up for the first time in a while.
I did. Took back to the stage. Like a moth to the flame.
And it felt good.
When was the last time you did stand-up, when you were 15?
It has been almost a full 10 years.
Really?
Yeah.
Such fun.
And did you get the bug?
I got some kind of bug. It's DC women are filthy. That's all I'm going to say.
Weird.
Apparently he was getting a lot of attention the first night.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At the bar. A lot of attention.
Guys got a swing.
A lot of attention from 40-something drunk gals. Thought I was some sort of after-dinner mint.
Do you want?
Not worth going into.
Do you want?
The kosher kind.
Do you want 40-somethings not drunk? Just checking.
You know, to each his own.
Sure. And Jamie?
I got to visit Springfield in our time off.
Yeah, we need
to. Springfield, the Simpsons area at Universal in Orlando, which made me very, very happy.
You had a Duff beer at Moe's Tavern.
I had a Duff beer at Moe's Tavern. You could also get a Flaming Moe, but it was non-alcoholic, so I went with the Duff. You could visit Duff.
Is cough syrup the secret ingredient?
It's not even purple. It's yellow.
I'm out.
But it does flame. There's dry ice in it, and it does flame up. But no, Moe's was great. They have a phone there on the bar, so Bart can crank call you and everything. They have the love tester in the corner. There's a Duff Brewery where they had the Seven Duffs outside and Lard Lad Donuts. You can visit the Quickie Mart. And for a Simpsons fan like me, it was heaven.
I loved it.
It was completely immersive.
Yeah.
I loved it.
And little did we know that E-Rock from O&A
yes.
was there at the exact same
yes.
time.
Yes, Eric Nagel from
Opie Anthony.
Opie Anthony.
Yeah.
Jim Norton, we had on the show, who was a regular on that program, was there at the same exact time.
Yeah, pretty cool.
I did not know.
And I was finishing up with the principal photography portion of my directorial debut, the feature film documentary Misery Loves Comedy, our very own Sam Levine appearing on camera, along with 66 other famous funny fuckers.
Do you really want to make that claim now before the edit?
Yes, this now is the time.
I've been in this spot before.
Now is the time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
It's important for everyone to know who was a part of it before they actually see it. Yeah, we're going to start Robert Legato, also a former guest and two-time Academy Award winner. And I will begin cutting this week through 70 hours of material. We need like an hour 40. I don't know. I guess I'll just have a weekly screening at my house with the rest of the footage.
That sounds great.
Until we get through it all. Lewis Black, Jimmy Gaffigan, Mike Birbiglia, O&A, aforementioned, Jim Norton, Amy Schumer, Janine Garofalo, Bobby Cannavale, who's so fucking funny it made me cry, Jimmy Fallon, Judd Apatow, Christopher Guest, Martin Short, Mark Maron, Maria Bamford, Penn Jillette, Matthew Perry, just to name way too many. Are you watching us right now live on the YouTube? Let us know how you watch the show. Write to us at contact at kevinpollockschatshow.com. You son of a bitch. Subscribe to us on the YouTube or the iTunes. And let us know how you're consuming. We'd love to hear from you. Contact kevinpollockschatshow.com. And, of course, we're dropping every Tuesday on Earwolf, my favorite damn comedy podcast network. Very excited about that. Jim Rash, Academy Award winner. Another Academy Award winner.
You ran into him on Thursday.
For the Descendants.
Oh,
we'll be here on the 27th. As will, I believe, your mother, Sam?
You betcha.
Yeah.
The great Little Levine herself.
Pretty excited about it?
I'm excited.
Well, Jason's excited.
Aren't we all?
You're not letting Pops Harris join?
No, I told you. He owes the mob money. He has to stay local. He's P.O. He's not allowed to leave the state. It's a whole thing. I can't go into it.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for that. No problem. All right. I believe that's all we have of old and new business. Yeah,
there it is. I agree with you more. I'm excited about where this is headed.
I am too. Oh, my one and only book apparently dropped on the Amazon in the soft cover when they changed the cover on the soft. I bitch and moaned about how the hardback came out, and I look like a Crasian. A Gaysian.
That's it.
Yeah. It would be.
You just, why do you keep looking to Kenny?
Gay Asian.
Like you need a couple. I love that Kenny just mumbles something to himself.
I imagine you're putting it up on the screen. I wouldn't know because, oh, there it is. The screen keeps busting out. So there's the, so that's me sitting at this very desk on the new cover. And pull up a picture of the original hardback cover. They didn't ask my permission to make me into a Gaysian on the original cover.
Yeah.
There it is. And they didn't ask my permission to changing the, oh, God, look at that. Why? My favorite thing, someone thought they were doing me a solid.
Yeah.
By airbrushing my eyes so that I would look 14.
Sure.
And Asian. I'll let's see. I guess I'll have the 14 gay Asian. 14. All right. My guest today, awfully damn excited. We've not had many from the music world. But, of course, he's an actor. Let's not forget that. We'll discuss a recent appearance on the lovely show Community. But pretty damn excited about this. Jamie, since I've known her, has been yelling at me about today's guest and how much his music meant to her as she sat on the bus alone. You want to talk about that at all?
No. You're thinking of something else.
Oh, that was Adam.
But no, I was in high school, yes.
It was the same time.
It was more of a, like, my best friend and I, like, we loved all, like, the alternative music and all, like, the bizarre movies that were coming out at the time, and everyone thought we were crazy.
Yeah.
It turns out we just had taste.
Yeah, used our guest today's music to help alienate you from the cool kids. Please welcome Ben Folds to the table. Hello, sir. Okay, first and foremost, shortly after we met, you were kind enough to invite me to a showing of your photography, which I wasn't able to attend. So please accept my apology, A, and tell us what that experience was like for you.
Oh, it was good. It was kind of like setting up a lemonade stand and waiting for people to show up.
Yeah.
And I've been making photographs for most of my life and printing them in the dark room, and it's been an obsession of mine for a long time. So this was like, it was the second showing I've had, but it was kind of the first in a way because I actually printed everything this time. And
right.
Yeah, it was pretty fancy. We had wine and stuff, and stand next to them and tell people what I was thinking when I shot it and stuff. It was nice. It was good.
How is that telling people what you were thinking when you shot it? That seems like...
Well, I don't think about that, right. Which is cool because when, you know, I'm used to that in songwriting. I'm aware that when I write a song, I can already hear the questions about it, and I don't like that I think that way, but you can feel where it's going, sort of. But, you know, these photographs were pretty much for myself and my friends and family, and to have them hung and, have everyone going through and seeing them was really cool. And I enjoyed trying to remember why I shot something, you know. Sometimes it was just because it was pretty.
Yeah.
You know.
And how did you get into it initially? Just became a hobby?
Yeah, I mean, my mother points out I was, you know, because film was more rare and expensive and cameras and things when we were younger. And so that would be a big treat for me to think, okay, well, I've got like a pack of, you know, 10 shots in a Polaroid. I'm going to think about what I'm going to do with this all day long. When my kids were born, I did the typical take 10,000 pictures of them with the digital camera.
Sure.
And I just realized, you know, no one wants to see this shit, and they're not going to want to see it either, and I'm probably going to lose the files. So
right.
I just started taking printing really seriously, which means you take your photographing really seriously because you begin to have to adjust your things for what you're printing in the dark room. And then right. I shot on tour, and then it just became... You know, I just mailed off back to a storage space. And Alicia and I just stacked up 4 or 5 big stacks of negatives and contact sheets and stuff. And I really must be crazy. It's a lot of work. I mean,
yeah.
It's really a lot of work.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
But clearly something you love. It's a passion.
Yeah, yeah. It's kept me sane. And it also, it links somehow to my music. I don't really know how. I just know that I used to spend, there's a couple albums I remember where I spent maybe 5 in the morning to maybe 1 or 2 in the afternoon in the dark room, grab a bite on the run, and then go in the studio until midnight. And so it was a big part of the day.
Hell even though, yeah.
Even though the music was the important part, something about the process was setting, you know, you're in the dark, you know?
Yeah. You like the setting of the composition? Is this something you were self-taught? Is there people that...
Yeah, see, my mother's a good artist. She's visual artist, painter. She's really good at that. And I never really was. I mean, my parents didn't play music or anything, so music was probably, in a way, kind of less likely for me than photography was. But I don't think about the composition that much. I shoot what feels right. And I get interested in things like tones, you know. It's like, oh, well, the light's kind of cool. This will look good on film. I think with photography, the meaning of it is, for me, is kind of an add-on side effect that I don't even realize. I'm completely unaware of that.
Just something for you to explain to people later when they ask, what's the meaning of this?
It's just for the gallery. Yeah, that's all it is. It's for the show when you're standing there with the wine. The rest of it, I don't know why I do, which I like, because with the song, I clearly know usually why I'm doing it. And I think it's a good thing to remind yourself that you don't, when you're creating something, you really don't have to know why you're doing it. You're not making a Hallmark card, you know? Which is a great thing too, but like, I don't write songs that way, so.
You never did?
No, I don't write topically, but I know what I'm doing, like, because I've done it so many times and people ask me questions and I've explained it, so now I'm fucked, you know. But with photography, I'm still innocent.
You know, yeah, that's exactly the word for it.
Yeah.
It's all very innocent at this point.
Yeah.
So you've probably been already asked about maybe doing a book of your photography.
Yeah, I have a few times, and I'd been asked to do, you know, showings and all kinds of things, but there's so many amazing photographers. I mean, crazy talented photographers who don't have the access to the audience that I might have, and I've always been real self-conscious about that. I don't want to, you know, but... You know, once you've stacked up a room full of negatives like that, I have to figure, well, I'm not part-time in this shit. I should probably put it up and, you know.
Yeah, and it's something for your fans also. Because that's one of the things I noticed in the research is that your fans, they like to get emotionally involved.
Mm.
And they like to get physically involved. There's a video of the paper airplane.
Oh, yeah.
So was that part of an entire tour or just a couple of one-offs?
Sometimes... If I've been touring for a while, and I feel like I've gotten locked into certain songs. They kind of narrow and narrow. You remember what you played last night and forget other things. And so sometimes I'll just tweet out or send out a note that says this is going to be a paper airplane gig, which means write your request on there, and we give them a little bit of direction before I come out. Like, you know, sound guy will say, you know, wait till he comes out and then launch him, and then light comes on, they count down and they launch them, and then the whole set I just play what's on the floor, unless it's a song that I've picked up three times before, and then then I just pick up the next one. But yeah, it's pretty cool.
That is really cool.
Yeah, it keeps you on your toes, keeps me on my toes. And also, you know, people don't expect then for you to remember all the words and the chords and stuff. You can fuck up all you want to.
That's great.
Because I do that anyway, but this gives me a license to do so. So I think I like things that keep me slightly scared, that I might not pull it off. And I constantly stay in that state. Everything I'm doing right now is the scariest thing I've ever done.
And how exciting is that to be scared after doing something so long?
I think it's really necessary for me. I mean, maybe scared's the wrong word.
But I know what you mean, though, because we talked about it in the documentary about people getting on stage and stuff, and it's about being brave enough to be scared initially, and then it's the desire to be scared, which just means out of your comfort zone. Really.
Well, comedy, I mean, stand-up comedy is, to me, the scariest sounding thing in the world. And if you haven't done it in 10 years, you must have been shitting your pants before you did your DC
gig. I was
gig.
Surprisingly calm because I was put in a position where I had already convinced myself it was going to be absolutely terrible. So anything slightly better than absolutely terrible was a victory. And I got very lucky. It was an extremely nice crowd.
It's good to set your expectations
high. Yeah, I'm thinking about putting out a book saying, just lower your expectations. Because it applies to everything in life.
Yeah.
You will not have a bad experience no matter what it is if you just remember to lower your expectations.
I'm trying to do it for 30 plus years.
Yeah, right?
That's my message.
I always ask the guests to do so ahead of time. Yeah, you know, the thing about being out of your comfort zone, by the way, comedy on stage only seems scary to someone that it isn't natural to.
Yeah.
For those of us that do it, and a lot of people talked about this, they're more comfortable there than anywhere else.
Yeah.
Because there's a sense of control when you're on stage, even though it looks incredibly scary to the non-performer. You know, you're like music sometimes, maybe, you know, the audience's energy will dictate sometimes certain pace. But for the performer, it dictates the pace a lot.
Yeah.
But in terms of the content, we're in control of the ride from beginning to end.
Right.
And that sense of control and doesn't actually exist in real life.
Mm.
So public speaking remains America's number one fear above death, thankfully, because then for those of us that feel comfortable doing it, we look special.
Well, yeah, I suppose you probably get that a lot. I mean, I think that's what everyone thinks, is that, you know, comedy is stand-up comedy, just by yourself with a microphone, standing on stage, just asking for people to throw shit at you.
Well, it just means we're more of a narcissist than you are.
Oh, no, I don't know.
Because we clearly need to be alone, get rid of everyone else.
Yeah.
Let me just be me, put all the lights directed at me. I'd like all the paying people to look, don't look at the bass player.
But it demands a response to be successful. I mean, even really music, you don't have to have the response. Everyone knows you're going to clap at the end of the song. That's kind of compulsory. But it's not compulsory to, like, go, you know, to, like, laugh like that. And yeah. That's real when people do that. I mean, what I just did wasn't real, by the way.
I was going to ask you about, in fact, touring in non-English-speaking countries. Because for music, what a joy.
Yeah.
I need them to understand what I'm saying.
Well, I think melodies have a personality and a meaning in themselves. And I see a lot of people that I think generate good melodies, but they don't have any soul or they don't have any meaning to them. And I don't know why I think I have the license to know this, but I really am opinionated about that. I hear a melody, it's like, isn't that a great melody? I'm like, yeah, it is. It just doesn't mean a thing. And when melodies come to me, they don't come with words. But they come at times when I'm obviously thinking and feeling things. And if I put if I put those melodies through my intellect first in the English language, I would edit a lot of it. But what happens is I end up with the melody first, and the melody means something because it wouldn't resonate with me if it didn't. And then I have to find the words. And until I find the words, every word that I put in and everything that I've got in there negates the true meaning of the until I get it right. And when I get it right, sometimes it's very unsettling because I then find out what it is that I'm actually thinking or feeling. So for me, that's there's a real trip there. So if I'm playing for, you know, non-English speaking people, audience, and I think that I would hope that they're feeling that without me having to translate it into English. Although, you know, like a country like Japan, they translate and read the stuff before they show up. The audiences there, I found, probably more aware of what the songs mean in some ways than the English-speaking countries that just take them for granted.
They've studied what would be the liner notes.
They studied the translations.
Wow.
They thought about it. It's really cool to show up knowing these things. Kind of like going to an opera and, you know, knowing what the guy's saying. You know?
Having done the research.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're going to the opera, kind of.
So that's kind of great.
Yeah, yeah, I think the Japanese audiences are amazing. And they stop clapping suddenly. I don't know if you wouldn't be doing comedy over there, although that would be kind of fun. Yeah, Tokyo, just like,
yeah,
they're laughing, there's like, dead silence.
Yeah.
What happened? Like, you really don't know what happened, but one time we played the first time we played in Nagoya, it was a punk rock club. And it was the 90s, and just people were just going fucking nuts. They were jumping off the stage. We didn't have enough security to, like, keep people from crawling on things and tying, like, ties as a head bandana and jumping, and they're just going nuts. And so the next time we played Nagoya was in a symphony hall, and I remember telling the band, I mean, this is going to be nuts. These guys are crazy. I saw the same people there. Like, there were people that was the same audience, and they just sat there. And they clapped and
wow.
They got quiet because it wasn't appropriate for them to be jumping off the stage at the symphonic venue.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Order and structure.
Yeah. They're just respecting where it is they are. It's like, I guess I gotta dive off the piano. That's what's expected. So.
Yeah. So I'm curious. Who your early inspirations were? I mean, you obviously get asked that by everyone, but it seems there's a Jerry Lee Lewis, there's a Little Richard, there's a physical necessity to injure the piano.
Yeah, I was really excited by that. I played piano. I always wanted to when I was a kid, and. When we got a piano, my father rolled it in from work. He had been remodeling a house, and this piano was the payment at this point. And I didn't know it was coming, you know. And when it showed up, of course, I was freaking out about this. And in the morning, I thought, I'm going to play it. So I was up all night with a transistor radio on my ear, which I wasn't supposed to have. And it's under my pillow, and I was listening to different pop songs of, you know, it's like 1976. I'm going, I'm going to play that. There's a Lou Rawls song, You'll Never Find, do. I can do that one. And like just thinking about what I could do. And I got up in the morning and I couldn't do any of it. I was upset. And my relationship with the piano for, you know, my whole teenage years was just pissed. I mean, I would try to do it. I couldn't do it the way I wanted to. I didn't really have a teacher. We lived in 13 houses before I graduated high school. And the routine became when we moved from one house to another, my bedroom, I would have to patch the walls and repaint because I would have punched through walls, I would have thrown things, and I would just go nuts. And I think that informed my piano playing some, but really what I discovered early on that I could do was that. I was like, this is cool. My parents were over that shit. Because I figured that out, like, you know, maybe month three of playing piano. So, and that was through...
Had you seen someone do that, though?
Little Richard.
Right.
Little Richard, my mother had, she had stacks of 45s, and they were all Little Richard and Elvis.
Wow.
And I broke the Elvis ones. I didn't think much of the Elvis. White motherfucker. Oh. It's like, I don't know what it was. I didn't relate to that. And
he was Caucasian.
That's what it was.
Even
it was
though he had been 100% inspired by African American.
It didn't sound gritty to me. Right. It didn't sound like it did sound like Vegas to me. And now I love it, but you know, it didn't sound right to me. And I do remember really not liking those. And they were the black records. They had the RCA label, sure, on them with the dog and stuff. And it's like that. I broke them all.
So it wasn't enough to not play them. You needed to physically destroy them.
I broke them. I know. It's bad.
Well, it's not bad. It's awesome. Because it's important to know what you like and don't like at an early age.
Yeah.
And
I didn't know that white people made music, really, or I didn't respect that they did up until I was about 12 or 13. And see, my father, because he would bring up so much music home from these houses he would work on, it was usually pretty rough sections of town. And, I mean, he packed a gun over there and mace and stuff and went and did his thing and had all these crazy stories when he came back. And then they just left the house and left all their records. So here you go, stack of records. And it was always James Brown and Wilson Pickett and Otis Redding and Sam and Dave. And that's all I knew.
Wow.
All I knew. And, you know, by the time I was 12 or 13, then HBO came around. And I saw Neil Sedaka. And I loved it. I saw, it was amazing. And that was weird because I've been listening to the radio, but somehow I just imagined all those people. You make music, you got brown skin. That's just the way I thought of it. And I didn't see anyone around me really making music. My parents didn't do that. No one's going to sing or anything. I thought this was something that came from somewhere else. And so Neil Sedaka, these beautiful chords. And he told a story about how he got his first song published when he was 13.
Yeah.
And I was like 11 or 12. And
you were ready.
I was ready. I tried really hard. I was going for it. I was writing songs. I would write them all down on staff paper and had stacks of songs.
Any of it makes sense?
Yeah. I mean, it very similar to what I write now in a lot of ways. I mean, if I played you melodically what I was writing when I was 12 years old, it's not that different than what I write now.
Are you also saying it's not much better?
Yeah. It's on par. It's more intellectually stimulating.
Yeah. There's the good news.
Yeah.
Because I'm not sure I'm going to be emotionally stimulated or intellectually stimulated by a 12-year-old. Could be.
Yeah.
But it also suggests that you had more than a calling. I mean, that's the extraordinary thing to me about certain artists, when they have a very specific calling, when there's nothing in their upbringing that was sort of the setup for it.
Yeah.
I mean, it seems like other than being loud, mm-hmm. You were being allowed to play and practice.
Yeah. My parents were really good about that. I mean, they didn't know anything about music, but they were real happy to see me do it. And I think they had good instinct, which is you let a kid do something that he's good at, that he wants to do, and other things will follow. And actually my grades and everything followed. As soon as I started playing music, I got smart. So it was good.
That's crazy.
And it's the way it works. That's why I spend a lot of my time putting effort into, you know, music education and awareness of music education and programs, because, God, I mean, if I didn't have music, and as a kid, like, we could just pick a band instrument. Okay, what do you want to play? It's like, can I play that? No, you can't play that, but you can play the cello. Okay, that's fine. They tune it up for you and you start playing. They don't have that now so much.
One of the first things to go in public schools, I'll bet.
Yeah, and it's not that expensive, and it actually helps your grades. Helps kids' grades. Everyone knows that. And they know the data and they know that. But for some reason you get scared. You go, well, my kids are not learning in 30 minutes of math. They're not learning it. We're going to have to take their head and shove it in it for another 20 minutes and maybe they'll learn it. We know that's not right.
Yeah.
But that's what they're doing. So
that's not how it works. Secondly, we must discuss our mutual love and admiration for and of the entity that is William Shatner.
Yeah.
When did that begin for you? Anyone watching or listening that has not heard the album Has Been, stop and find it, and you're welcome.
Oh.
It's unfucking believable. It's so far beyond as good as it should be because of his involvement.
Yeah,
honestly. And as a lifelong fan, I say that with as much love and respect as is humanly possible. It still can't add up to that level of perfection. I mean, from the emotion to, okay, so first of all, give me just like the genesis. How does this come to your thoughts?
Well, you know, when I was a kid and I was trying to, I wanted to be a songwriter, and Neil Sedaka had done it by the time he was 13, and I didn't, you know, and I was, but I was still going for it. One of the things I did in high school is I really liked, at a yard sale, I bought the William Shatner record, the one, Transformed Man.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the one that has Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. And
Rocket Man.
And Tambourine Man.
Tambourine Man. Tambourine Man, that's what it was, Tambourine Man.
Rocket Man was the one-off.
Yeah. Tambourine Man.
Yeah, just, Tambourine Man.
Yeah, he just keeps screaming it.
Right? Yeah, it's really
good. So you see what I'm saying? There's no perfection there.
He didn't know what he had done. Like, I asked him about that record, and he said, well, you know, it was a day, and we were shooting Star Trek, and it was one thing on his list, and he did it in real time. It was like a 45-minute thing, and he didn't even know what he'd done. He just left it. Now, then it became this huge cult classic. But see, to me, because I'd heard it at a really young age, what was amazing to me was how compelling his voice was.
Yeah.
You know, and I was listening to that stuff with no irony at all. It's just that, how many voices do you hear? Especially in that era, every actor had to have this grand voice. You know, now it's not so much the case, but
yeah, like Vincent Price. And,
oh, they had these amazing voices.
Very specific.
Yeah, baritones and basses and for some reason, I listened to him, and I listened to that record, and I think I got it. And so when I was in high school, I wrote a song for him to speak, and I even said it like him. I wrote a song.
You did. I wasn't going to point that out.
Channeling Bill now.
I'm glad you caught it.
He came to my photo gallery, actually. He made it around.
Yeah, he made it.
It's okay. He mentioned it. He didn't mention it on his show.
See?
So that's okay. He didn't buy anything either. But the
is the stuff still there, by the way?
It is.
Oh, good.
Yeah, yeah.
Great, because I was
Santa
hoping
Monica.
It would be.
Yeah, Santa Monica Gallery 169 is there for another few weeks.
Oh, awesome.
Anyway, I wrote in this note. Someone told me William Morris Agency is where I write it to, so I wrote it, and Mr. Shatner, I've got a song for you, and I got back a form letter,
right,
and that was that. And then I made an album as soon as we had our first hit. I was like, you know what, I really should do this song. Like, I've got a license to do this now. I bet you I could get this through. So I had my record company ask him again, and I guess, I think maybe a daughter was a fan or something, and he answered and said, yeah, he'd do it. So then I made tracks to the music. I brought it to Los Angeles. I was waiting. He was about 2 hours late. He was stuck on the freeway. I started reading it and realized it was an idiot song. It was like I wrote it when I was 18 years old, and it's just a piece of shit. It just wasn't very good.
You realize that as you're sitting there waiting for him?
Because he was late. And so I just scrapped it and wrote something completely new for him to do when he showed up. And we did the song, and it was on an album called Fear of Pop. And this was in 1998. And we became buds after that. We just really got along. His friend that was with him, his close friend, I guess, pulled me aside and said, you know, he's really bad at taking direction. And you just like raked him over the coals for an hour and a half, and he seemed to love it. This is just really amazing. And he called me and asked me about things, you know, like, I'm doing this music thing, what should I do? And someone told him they wanted to make a record on him, as a record company. So he called me up, and I was driving my van on tour. And he said, Benny, I've got this idea. I'm going to make an album. And they wanted him to do, I think.
That sounds exactly like him. I know. That's so great.
they wanted him to do, like Material Girl by Madonna and stuff like that. They wanted him to do something silly. And I said, well, listen, when I pull over, I'll send you an email. I'll just give you some ideas. And I said, I think you should do a song with Joe Jackson. I think you should do a song with Amy Mann and Henry Rollins. And I think you should write your own words and let people who know what we're doing put it to music, who love what you do. Like, you've got so many fans, like, we're gonna put heart and soul into this thing, and just tell the truth. Like, don't. And it occurred to me later that was really, I was unwittingly probably the smartest thing I could have said to him was tell the truth, because really, had he done that before? I mean, actors, you know, that's not what you do really all the time.
It also changed his career, by the way, when he went on Saturday Night Live and did that sketch with the Star Trek convention and said, you people, get a life.
Yeah.
When he told that truth.
That's true.
It's when he went from being the joke to being in on the joke.
Yeah, that's
and
right.
And it changed the next 25 years of his life in that one moment.
Yeah. And he's aware of what, but he's also is vague enough.
Right.
To even when you know him, not knowing which things were supposed to be funny and which weren't. And then he enjoys three quarters of that, and I think the other quarter he's not aware of, which is a real artist. That's what a real artist is. You know, you don't know exactly what it is you're doing, and I think it's amazing. He does. He's dangerous in the studio. He never does a take the same way. You can't edit his takes. He does one thing, and if you try to move it, he's not musical, really, but if you move his timing a little bit just to try to make it a little more in, it's gone. So I didn't touch that stuff. I just let it go. It's like he sent me 50 poems in like 3 days. He just, all these stories from his life and stuff that meant something to him, and he wrote them, and I was really impressed.
So he generated the material.
Absolutely. Now, I went to my friend Nick Hornby, the British author, novelist, for one, because I thought I'd like to have one that's just airtight writing, you know, and he wrote one of them, and the rest of them were all Bill.
Which one did Nick write?
It's called That's Me Trying.
Yeah, I love that.
I wrote the lyrics for the chorus to make a musical chorus out of it for him, and Nick wrote the rest of the words, and then we just put some music behind it, and Bill read it a couple times. I think the first time he didn't get it, he's just reading it. Second time, I think it really hit him, and he was completely teared up at the end of it. It was the take we use, because if someone cries while you're recording them, you have to use it.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. Yeah, you don't have a choice.
Yeah.
Jesus. And so has been the title track.
The title track, that was one I was really, I intervened a lot in that one because he had given me a thing that I thought sounded maybe a little too bitter. I understand why. I mean, it was kind of like, I'm sick of people calling me a has-been, you know, like, if you're, at least I did something, you know, and I might.
Better than I never was.
Yeah, better than I never was, and I might do it again. But I kind of felt like it was a little too literal, and so I just started thinking about putting him on like a really bad Western set and having a couple of characters, you know, because he had mentioned, you know, maybe has been, will again, never was, and just making it a little bit silly so that it would give him a way to say it in an entertaining way. But most of the time, what I would do with him is
like
try to...
Don't Know Jack?
Don't Know Jack, never done shit. Yeah, yeah.
And
you know, I gave him that chorus, you know, riding on, da, 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 da. I can't remember the words now, but fear is their companion, Nintendo is their game, you know.
Yeah.
I gave him that so that he would have something kind of funny to launch off of there and to make his point, because you don't want to, you know, you don't want to point your finger and preach. And it's my whole gig was to protect him. I mean, he's giving me the truth, and then it's like, okay, Bill, I'm not letting you be a clown. Like, that ain't gonna happen. And that had been our relationship since before. And, you know, every once in a while, he'll go, Benny, you're pecking me like a chicken. Like, he just like, just lose it. Cause I had a couple things I had him rewrite about 15 times, you know. But I didn't want anyone to listen to it and laugh before they got the real part. You know, he's 75 years old when we made this album, and he had a lot of stuff to say. I mean, you know, wife died in his pool. That's a big responsibility for someone to give you a poem like that, and you're like, I took the easy way out too. I didn't put a lot of music to it. I made that the part that,
right,
I brought in a double bassist, and he played basically effects, you know, and I actually used Bill's, I interviewed him for 2 days, where we just sat. It was kind of dramatic because I know he liked drama. We dropped a bulb, lights out in the studio, and I set up a microphone. I said, we're going to talk for about 6 hours if you've got it, you know. And we did that a couple of days, and I went through all the tapes. And I knew that when he was reading the one and talking about it, I had him read all the parts too. And when he read the one about Noreen dying in the pool, I knew I wasn't going to make him do that again.
Right.
I just wasn't going to do that. He had done it. And he was getting nervous about it. I said, no, actually, I finished it. I put a bass on it, and you're done.
Yeah, he was about as crazy as someone could be for her. I was fortunate enough to actually be at that wedding.
Mm.
And, man, it was just kind of ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's odd when you're at a wedding and you say to the couple, you two want to get a room because they can't stay away from each other. Yeah, and also I like the notion of protecting him because he not only, you know, does it make sense, but, you know, without that, he has a natural comedic essence to him, yeah. which is one of the things we love.
Yeah.
So if he's got this meaningful stuff that he's going to write and share, his truth,
yeah.
that is so phenomenal.
Yeah.
But the best way for it to be embraced is if he also uses his sense of humor with it.
Right. Well, that's why I think comedy is, that's the rock and roll of now. Like, rock and roll's not that dangerous. The last thing that was dangerous about rock and roll was the way people downloaded it, they took it. And that's dangerous. But the music itself, I don't find that dangerous. Mm. But comedians, you know, like, I'll put on Pandora and listen to comedians on a long drive or something because I get the same thing out of that as I got out of rock and roll. But you got to watch it because it can't be, to me, comedy has to be tied to something real. You know, it has to be, for me, something that is real inside. That's what makes it funny. But it's not just funny. There's more to it. It's triggering other things. And music, I've always found, needs humor. But the way people market music, if there's too much humor in it, they call it a novelty song. Right. It's like, if you actually get a laugh out of something, suddenly it's like it's no good.
Yeah.
It's like it has to kind of be sort of funny. I hate that word, like novelty song. Because why shouldn't you, you know, people laugh at funerals. They don't mean to. And they laugh at all kinds of things. Well, why can't that be? And Vincent Price, who you brought up, I remember seeing an interview when I was a kid, and he was saying that nothing that was scary was ever scary without a little humor. Like, to him, it had to have humor. And he's like, his voice is funny. So these things are funny because as soon as someone kind of, it makes it scarier. I mean, if you think about it, it really does. And,
well, it makes it human.
Yeah.
And you lower your defenses, yeah. I think.
That must be it. I mean, like, I actually didn't see the movie, but the Hannibal Lecter one, I mean, he's funny, right?
Exactly.
I mean, that's funny, and I don't know why it works, but it works in music, too. But with Shatner, it couldn't be too much. So right. I really found myself telling him not to act at all. It's like, he goes, I know, but that timing was funny, trust me. It's like, I know, but just read it. Just read it this time, see what happens. And usually those were the ones that were the most effective to me, were the ones where he was asked, you know, I made him tie one half of his brain behind his back, and I thought that was still funny. I mean, he's still funny.
Yeah.
But something about him just going through the motions was working for me better than when he was giving it a shot. But if you do five takes of him, everyone's utterly different. They're all over the shot.
How early in the process does the younger version of you evaporate with the excitement of this is actually happening? Because I find that when I'm around him, it doesn't really go away.
Yeah, he's one of those.
There's always an awareness that I'm.
He's one of those people. Yeah, yeah. It is like that. I think it's different for different people. I mean,
yeah.
He and I just were kind of both kids really quickly. And I don't find that with many, you know, performers. Most performers I have a hard time. So I had kind of the opposite thing. I see people do that with him. You know, you can't go anywhere with him at all. It's just they come out of buildings and stuff. Like, you're walking along and it's just like, and they're coming out. The Walking Dead. Where?
Yeah, how many people call you Benny, by the way?
Yeah, he's it. That's it.
He's the only one?
Yeah.
Well, that kind of says it all.
Yeah, that's right. It's the only one I allows it. Benny, it's Billy.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and he doesn't refer to himself as Billy.
No.
No?
No, that's Benny and Billy.
That's pretty damn great, man.
Yeah, it's cool. He's a good dude.
Because meeting heroes can be so damn disappointing. It's just anticlimactic. And a lot of it has to do with those annoying expectations I mentioned earlier.
Yeah. Yeah, but you never know who you're going to get nervous about no matter how important they are. Some people's kind of like, and I remember hearing Elton John say that about the Beatles. He's like, Paul McCartney, he just never got comfortable with. John Lennon and him just seemed like best buds right off the bat. And that's really unlikely. You wouldn't think that. But some people, it's their relationship with each other is more kind of like playground. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. The playground unfolds and then suddenly you're sitting there sharing a sandwich or something or beating the shit out of each other. It's just a kid thing.
I wonder if it had to do with the sense of humor. Because obviously Lennon was the funny one.
Yeah.
Between the two of them.
Yeah, probably so.
Paul's just terribly sincere, isn't he? Oobie doobie. Is that the Dana Carvey? Paul McCartney?
That's good.
Oobie doobie. And then he saw Paul do that, actually in an interview, say oobie doobie, and he shit himself and became too meta. He couldn't handle it. Gallery 169 at Santa Monica, a couple more weeks, huh?
Yeah.
We gotta check that out, please. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about your ease, comfort, and seeming necessity to work outside the box, kind of on everything. And I know in reading some of the past interviews, you got a little annoyed with the use of alternative or other such titles or categories.
I even get annoyed with myself for being annoyed with categories because it's so cliche. It's like, I can't be categorized. But it is annoying. I don't know. It's just, it's hard to, you don't want something getting in the way of a direct line to what you're creating.
Yeah.
You know, so if you're going to have to veer it, if some part of you says, okay, we're going to veer it just to the left or right a little bit to put it in this place, that's what I don't like. It's, right. I don't find it insulting as much as I don't want to be poisoned by it. I don't want to think that's what I do. I right. never wanted to know that's what I did. Or I do want to know that, but I don't want to know that.
Sure.
You know, it's like for comfort you want it. But so, yeah, alternative, I don't know.
Well, if you're going to exist in your creative, artistic mind outside the box at all times, when the box becomes alternative,
yeah,
you have to think outside of alternative.
Yeah. As soon as someone said outside the box, they killed it.
Yeah.
So there's the, then there's no box anymore. It's like it's outside the box. It's all bullshit.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you know, we don't – the things that I do aren't that different from – anything else I do. So I don't pretend that I exist in the Grand Canyon. I exist in a really small place when I make things. It's just I don't want it to be any smaller than that if I can help it.
Right.
You know, but we do the same. I think all artists do the same things over and over again. It's just what we do. But you want to do it like it's the first time. You don't want to do it like, this is verse is just not as good as the first verse. It needs to be like the first. In fact, I always take second verses and shift them into the first. It's a constant habit of mine writing songs is to go, really? Okay, let's do that. Starts you in the middle of the story, plus it starts, you just don't start with, well, once upon a time, like, because that's where you want to start. So I trick myself every single time. I've almost finished the song and I take that second verse and I move it in. Or maybe half the time I do that.
Right. Well, at some point, the idea that you're thriving based on your own creativity, at your own pace, on your own terms, all that stuff. I mean, that is success.
Yeah.
Top to bottom.
And like we live in this era where we can just do, you really can, I mean, you have to do it on the cheap, but you can do anything, really. Yeah. I mean, we have light, it's like it's there's something post-apocalyptic about the entertainment industry now, and it's kind of like you can just pick up a couple pieces of things on the ground, put duct tape around, and go, I made a thing.
Yeah.
You know, and like I'm writing a piano concerto right now, and it's really, it's a lot of concentration, and it is scary. But because of the times we live in, I feel like I have license to do that, you know? And yeah, I feel the weight of Rachmaninoff, Prokofiev, and Bartok.
But that's it, though. That's just bullshit insecurity based on history. That's got nothing to do with whether or not you can do it.
Right. It's true.
And the same thing you were saying, excuse me for interrupting, but about the photography.
Mm.
You feel a sense of respect for people who've given their lives to just that as their art form. But the truth of the matter is, thanks to the iPhone and every other smartphone, everybody's a photographer now, and Instagram has made everyone publishable, which is maybe the beginning of the end.
Yes.
I believe it's the 17th sign of the apocalypse.
It's the beginning of something. It's the end of something, too.
Yeah.
But it does feel like we can do it, like you're doing this show.
Yes, exactly. I walked in our previous studio space. I was visiting my friend and walked in the studio space, and before I could stop the words from coming out of my head, I said, I think I want to do a Charlie Rose but fun from here. And I'd never even thought that.
Right.
And unfortunately for me, he said, how soon can you start? And
perfect.
Yeah, it really did come out of thin air.
Right.
And you got to do it on the cheap. You got to burn your own money until we find lovely folks like Tonks.
Yeah.
They're telling me I need to do the mid-roll for. You know, but the truth is, you can kind of do anything. So then the responsibility is yours.
Yeah.
Then you, to me, you only have you to answer to.
Yeah.
Have reverence and respect for.
You should. Yeah. but not to the point where it weighs you down. And we have, like, you know, we have the license. Like, you don't need a license. You're just doing it. You just took it and just did it. And the same thing, like, right. I walked into a dinner never thinking about doing a piano concerto, and I left. We were going to sign papers in a couple weeks for the commission. It was done. And I was like, oh, shit. Now you have to do it. I have to do it. But I really feel lucky to live in this time where we can do all these things, you know?
Yeah.
So I do them. And it's easier than if I kept writing pop music over and over again, because that does become a burden. Your last record, your record before, and expectations and who you are, and you've been defined, and you've had so many people tell you who you are and what you do, and then you don't want to let that down, but you don't let yourself down, and you react against it, make something that's too far left just to show them all. And, you know, I'm doing this concerto, and I have to be finished on November 1st. I know kind of what it sounds like, you know, and I've got a lot of pieces together, and it's a lot of music, and I've got mock-ups and stuff, but, I mean, I don't know. It could be anything, and I'm going to find out, and I love that.
Yeah. You're going to find out in less than 3 weeks.
Mm-hmm. It's done.
That's pretty damn exciting.
Yeah, it's very exciting.
All right, let me deal with thanking the folks at Tonks, if we may. Hey, folks, and by that I mean everyone watching and listening. We've got a great sponsor on today's episode of The Chat Show. It's Tonks, T-O-N-X. Tonks is a coffee delivery service that guarantees fresh beans on your doorstep biweekly. They're run by a small, tight-knit team of experts whose mission is to provide their subscribers with the greatest coffee in the world. Sign up to receive freshly roasted Tonks beans and brew right in your own damn kitchen. Okay, let me put this into words that you can imagine. Fresh coffee every day for the rest of your days. How about that? Just so you know, great coffee has very little to do with fancy gadgets and flashy gizmos, like the one at my house. It sounds like an airplane taking off. Tonks handpicks the farmers that source their beans, that they source their beans from, and get a new shipment of coffee beans from a different region every 2 weeks. Sample coffee from around the globe without getting out of your robe. How great does that sound, Sammy?
I don't ever get out of my robe. Sorry, Tonks.
I'm soaking in it. Get a free sample using the URL tonks.org/pollack, P-O-L-L-A-K. See what you've been missing. That's tonks.org/pollack for a free sample of some of the best damn coffee in the world. Thank you, Tonks, for caring enough about our little show here. So the pop happens with Brick, right? That's the first radio hit single on the second album.
Yeah, we'd had alternative radio hits,
right.
And we had a couple top 40 hits in the UK. Brick was the first one that was like across all the formats, and it was a total relief because we'd put so much into it, and it seemed like the fix was in, and we were supposed to have a hit. Mm. They put the money into it. We were everywhere. It wasn't dropping. And in fact, the record was, I think it was released three times. I think Brick was released as a single at least twice. Hmm.
Yeah. So that means it makes the rounds at all the various program directors and whatnot at the time who decided whether or not to put it into rotation.
Yeah, and they decided or not the first, you know, couple times. And the third time, the head of our record label, Polly Anthony, who just passed away recently, she got on a plane and went to the radio stations, and she said, "You're gonna play this," and that's why they played it. That's, you have to have someone that's gonna do that most of the time.
I imagine that doesn't exist anymore.
I don't know. I haven't seen it. I'm sure it must exist somewhere, but you just never know what it's gonna be. It might be someone who owns a furniture company or something. I mean, I don't know who owned the record company that the Avett Brothers are on, but. That's not a record company, right? Like, they were like some kind of investors.
Right.
They probably didn't know any better, and they probably like wined and dined people, you know.
Yeah.
Made it happen. I don't know. Maybe they didn't do anything. Their music is great. Might not need anything, but. You know.
Right. But yeah, so crossing over like that changes the tour, I imagine. When.
I mean. It's bit my lip. Is it bleeding?
Oh, no.
You know, first of all, we had an earthquake here with Henry Winkler, so don't.
Okay.
Yeah.
An earthquake with Henry Winkler.
When Henry Winkler was a guest on an Easter Sunday, we had an earthquake, and it was a rumbling one, a rolling one that lasted for a while. So the bit lip is not going to set us back.
Okay,
you're
good, good,
be
good.
Fun.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. We had.
I just want to be talking and.
By the way, better for us if you actually sustain an injury.
Yeah, Barbara Walters used to make him cry, but you make him bleed.
I like to make him bleed.
That's right. People will know we don't edit these videos.
That's right.
You can see, you know, that's where he split his lip. See the blood grudging down his chin. Now it's back up. Oh, it's all clear they cut it.
That is specifically why we don't edit. 2 million units sold, though, for Whatever and Ever, Amen.
Oh, that's a lot of records. And
is that double platinum, 2 million units? Is it 1 million units makes a platinum?
Yeah, 1 million makes a platinum. They stopped. It kept going after a while. They stopped counting. And they don't give you the. They don't give those to you after a certain point. So I don't even think we got our platinum certificates. It went double, I think, but I never saw that. So.
Yeah, well, that must have been on a need-to-care basis.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I gave the gold one to my mother thinking she's going to be really impressed with this because I was kind of self-conscious about hanging up in my shitty house, and I forgot to look for it at her house and realized years later it was under her bed. So
she was protecting it.
She was afraid someone would see how nice it was and steal it.
Yeah.
She's like, oh, I got to keep this secret and away from people.
It's like a dream, the opposite of a dream catcher, which I guess it catches the stuff that rises. This caught whatever went down underneath the bed. The dream dung catcher. I don't know.
Yeah.
But it's a cool thing to have those awards, but I don't have any of them up on the wall yet. I got one for I Am Sam. On the studio wall, did a Beatles song for that and got a gold or platinum record for that one. But I haven't gotten many awards and things. So, but yeah, that sold a lot of records and it did change things because we were moving the piano ourselves, me and two guys.
Yeah, I want to talk to you about that too. Because in the early days, literally, you're moving the piano.
Yeah. The show we talked about at the Troubadour was the last one that was the first one I didn't move the piano on.
The first one?
The first show that I didn't move my own piano on the stage.
Did you go to move it and someone said, no, I got this?
No, I was really sick. And we were starting to break. And I don't know in the sequence of things if Brick was successful yet or not, but everything was kind of breaking. And we were having to do a lot of work. And I was just sick. I had like 102 or 3 fever and I couldn't do it. So someone else moved the piano and I went to a doc and felt really weird about it because I showed up and the piano was set up. I was like, wow, that's weird. I mean, I'm so used to doing it myself. We'd drive up to the venue, have to get cars to move out of the way so we could roll it down the ramp, put it on stage. Did all that ourselves for about 3 or 4 years. So yeah, that changed because when Brick was a hit and everything started kind of coming in, suddenly I didn't have to move my piano anymore. And I felt tons of guilt for that. I felt like, oh man, my crew, like we used to do things together, and suddenly I wasn't like one of the guys flying his ass crack around the stage anymore. And for a while, I had this stupid thing I would do, and I would wear like a long hair wig and a leather jacket to move the piano in with, and then I would play with my normal self.
Who was the wig and jacket for?
I guess it was for me, probably for my entertainment. But some of it was because I got treated so rudely at punk rock clubs for looking really conservative and not artistic or punk rockish or tattooish or peroxide hairish enough. Mm-hmm. And those guys were really, so many of them were just utter assholes. And we'd move the piano and they'd say, it wouldn't move stuff out of the way for you. They wouldn't open the door. They'd give you half the time to set up that the guitar bands had to set up, and you'd hear them call you pussy behind your back and stuff.
Because you had a piano.
Yeah, because I'm moving it myself, and I weigh 130 pounds. That makes me a pussy. But yeah, he's like, have you ever heard of a digital piano, dude? Wow. What's that? What is that? It's, I think one time I just did that as a joke, and it was kind of fun, so I must have done it for about 3 months on tour, 3 or 4 months, you know, just kind of, okay, I'm going to put it on now, remove stuff and say, yeah, get the fuck out of my way, dude, and move it in and stuff, and like, yeah, this guy's all right, and
yeah,
and then I'd play my gig as you know, play my show. Wasn't cool. Being cool was so important. I mean, I think it's important now, but like the 90s was just like, you know, it's like the cool Nazis were everywhere. It was really uncomfortable. I don't know if you know or if anyone else noticed that, but I felt like it was really oppressive.
Yeah, well, that's what one of the things I was going to ask about, breaking out in the time of grunge being it.
Yeah.
The anti-slick, the cool kids had changed once again.
Yeah.
And it had exploded on a level of, this is what you want to emulate if you want to make it now.
Mm-hmm. Quickly.
Yeah. But at the same time, there was that punk thing.
Yeah.
That wouldn't let go.
Yeah, and the grunge stuff, yeah, that did come from the first incarnation of punk in the 70s. It's a direct sort of line to that. And everything looks different. If you look at when Nirvana broke, if you go back and look at Nirvana playing like Top of the Pops, which is amazing. It's one of my favorite. That just Nirvana on Top of the Pops is hilarious. And everything that MTV, everything they played on, looked so 80s. Mm-hmm. Like they came on and looked completely new. And nothing had caught up to Nirvana yet. And then within about 6 months, everyone changed their sets. They changed what they wore. Everything changed. And it was just because of them. And I felt inspired by them because, you know, maybe I didn't feel accurate enough to be Neil Sedaka. But if you take a song like a Neil Sedaka, I wrote a song it's almost a ripoff in some ways. It's called Missing the War, and it's on our second record. And there's a Neil Sedaka song called Solitaire. They've got similar chords, not enough for him to sue me. But I mean, they've got similar chords in them, and his is like the epitome of 70s slick ass, you know, white guy music. Mm. And we beat our song up. You know, it's got fuzz bass, got mistakes in it, it's got dirty word here and there. It's been ripped at the seams some because that's what we enjoy doing. So I was taking a great, these were my people had landed. When Liz Phair's record came out and Nirvana was out there and I loved Rage Against the Machine, and even the most kind of quote corporate things like Counting Crows was so much more dangerous because Adam never sang the same way twice, like it's all dangerous. And I was like, yeah, we're in. And we started touring, and I didn't expect to get treated like such a pussy, but I think as soon as they were literally expecting a cookie cutter grunge band to come on stage. And we played ear splitting levels. I mean, I played through two stacks of Marshall amps with my piano, and we played everything twice as fast to prove that we were as punk rock as anyone. But the songs in themselves are very not. I mean, they're crafted songs.
Well, yeah, someone was just talking about you playing through the Marshalls. The fuck was that? It looks like it was yesterday. Where was I? I'll have to remember, but they were talking about how sort of music aficionados were loving the fuck out of that. Like musicians were really excited that this was blasting through a double Marshall stack.
Yeah.
I one of the things I noticed almost immediately about your sound, if one's allowed to say that, is that sometimes it feels like you're thriving in chaos.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm wondering what sort of jazz inspiration may have.
Yeah, I think some of it is that since I was never really completely formally trained, maybe this is my theory of the moment. I don't think I've ever really thought or said this before, but I think I needed some chaos and confusion there because I wasn't so sure I was necessarily doing everything right. And you can create the impression.
Wow.
Like when I play piano still, like I play in a lot, I'm mashing my hands into the keys and playing thunder around the notes on downbeats and places. I mean, even if it's a thing that's supposed to be clean, I'm still, you know, I do that, and that's part of my style.
Yeah.
And I think some of it is like, I play guitar that way too because I can't get my hand to the next chord fast enough, so I just play some noise and some jazz. cue up an explosion, you know, and you get through it that way. And I think that's some of it. It's kind of like, because it means something. It's human. Like as I'm working with a guy who's kind of copyist, helping orchestrate the concerto. Mm-hmm. Still touchy about that part because I'm really orchestrating the shit out of it. But I do have someone there who has done this a million times and can tell me, you know, the clarinetist just passed out. Like he has to breathe. Oh, that's right. Or why don't you try giving that to the oboes instead, just see if you like it. So I've got this experience there with me. But sometimes I create a cloud. He's like, it's just murky there. It's like, that's just not, yeah, nah, I like it.
Yeah.
I like that because people walk out of, in movies they do it all the time, they walk out of smoke. Like, why can't we do that? Take the end of the bar and create smoke and then walk out of it. I like that.
Yeah. How do you like writing for the motion pictures? You did so on several films now.
Yeah, I mean,
Ron Howard's Grinch.
Yeah, I contributed a lot to a lot of movies. Where sometimes I'll see the movie and see the scene. Sometimes I won't. When I did Over the Hedge, which was a kids movie for DreamWorks, I was really involved in that one. So, you know, it was a lot of working with Hans Zimmer and everyone in that team. And I found that really interesting. But, you know, people that work on movies, they have this thing about on the nose. And it's the first thing, the first bit of criticism that comes up. And, like, there's, like, 10 people in a committee. And they'll all say it's on the nose. I think even before they listen to it, I like on the nose. Like, I like Fantasia. And, you know, like, there's a leaf falling and the music's going with it. I mean, I don't know. Maybe that's still really naive. I don't maybe know enough about movies. But I find it really difficult to say when something's on the nose or not, if it's helping. And maybe to me, I've just got a movie that's playing in my head when I write songs anyway. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm getting better at that. Like I'm getting closer to it. But like the movie About Time is coming out pretty soon, and I think that's going to be a big movie. It's a Richard Curtis movie. He made Four Weddings and a Funeral, and he's just great movie maker. And he used my song The Luckiest through the whole movie. I mean, it comes up and up and up. It must come up like 4 or 5 times, the instrumental version of it. And I would have never written that for that movie, but it's perfect. So there's that art that I'd like to get of watching the visual and then having it come to you. But it's such a committee, this movie-making business, you know, that you know, you even get the stuff back and they've moved it like 2 frames, and that's a problem for me because I kind of liked it to work here, but suddenly they cut something out and they just laid the music across it. So maybe one day I'll grow into it. I really want to do it when I grow up. It's something I want to do. And every time I do an interview about it, I start talking about how much I can't do it and how much it pisses me off. And I imagine all these movie makers going, oh, not him. But I want to nail it sometime, and I expect to. Like, I want to take a good independent movie, something that I really, really my heart's invested in. And I love the Ragtime a score that Randy Newman did for that, I think is amazing. And I always loved the To Kill a Mockingbird theme, main title and all that stuff. And that's something I'd like to do. But I can do that when I'm 70 or something. But one day I will do that. I want to do it.
I'll have the script waiting for
yes.
you in your email inbox.
While we're still asking him about
Please.
His film work, I'm just curious, you did produce a song for the 2001 film, Not Another Teen Movie, didn't you?
I recall that. Yeah.
Yeah, you do seem to recall
you
that.
You look really familiar.
That's one of my proudest memories.
Yeah, speaking of Gaysians from the beginning.
Was I playing it gay?
I don't know.
Yeah, no, but that was amazing for me because we did this movie, Not Another Teen Movie, and Joel Gallen directed it, who's like this big music video MTV guy. And he was like, and we were all worried. We're like, Joel, we're not singers. You're going to make us sing this song in the middle of the movie. He's like, it's okay. I'm getting Ben Folds to help us out. It's going to be fine. And I was like, really? Okay. And so then I show up to a studio, and I walk into the booth, and it's like, oh, this is Ben. Okay, put the headphones on. Now he's going to show you how to sing. I was like, what? Okay. And I am not a singer. And here's the only note I remember. I kept doing it very poorly. And you nailed me. You went, all right, you're good, but you're Neil Diamonding it. Because I kept going, burr, and you're like, Neil Diamond, we don't need that.
Well, the line was, even with the with dirty slut.
Even with dirty slut. That's right. Yes, that killer line. And so that was...
You know what my line was in it? They left the line cook was my voice.
That's
and
right.
And said, I just jerked off in your French toast.
That's totally right. And
who hasn't wanted to sing that lyric, by the way?
Honestly. So that was a tremendous treat meeting you low those many years ago, because I, like Jamie, was a huge fan in my teens. And I used that as a...
Yeah. Teens of the 90s.
Teens of the 90s. That was my barometer of who I would hang out with.
Absolutely. Yeah. I had the same exact thing.
It really was.
Me and my best friend, we were the ones that were like, you know, listening to this music and going to see like the Paul Thomas Anderson movies and all that stuff. And everyone's like, you guys are freaks.
Watching Conan.
Yeah, watching all that stuff.
If we couldn't talk about the most recent Ben Folds album, it was like, have a nice day. I'll see you around.
I'm wondering how many people I got beat up back in the day.
I think the answer is a lot.
I had a Ben Folds 5 t-shirt that said, kiss my ass. I wore it at school.
Really?
I did.
Yeah, just to make sure you got your ass beat.
Yeah, just kick my ass.
Why take chances? Yeah. We like to involve the listening, watching audience live. They actually form questions specifically for you, a list of five this or that Coke or Pepsi type questions. We call this a Tweet Five.
Team Five, Team Five, Team Five forever now.
Thank you, Dave Checkman.
That's good.
This one is from the Twitterverse at actually Mark. Are you ready? King's pawn or queen's pawn?
What does that mean?
That's so specifically designed for you that you yourself have no idea what it means.
King's pawn or queen's pawn?
Yeah.
I don't know, queen's pawn?
Correct.
Okay.
There is no correct answer, actually.
Okay, good.
Cat's Cradle or Franklin Street?
Oh, Cat's Cradle, yeah.
Cafe Dryad or Cafe Trio?
What does Dryad mean?
Good question. I may be mispronouncing it. Driade, cafe with two F's.
Oh yeah, some of that silence is cafe Drew.
Drew. Yeah.
I don't know. I take the trio since I know what that means.
Okay. Time Out or Peppers?
Oh, Peppers.
Chapel Hill or New York City?
Oh man, you know, sorry Chapel Hill, but New York City is really a pretty amazing place.
Yeah. All right. You did so well with that one. Here's another one. Well, actually, this is just a question that came in from Tom Jackson Jr. from our Facebook page that I've never seen.
Sorry.
Just because I personally refuse to do the Facebook, but thankfully.
Give me both.
Yeah. Danielle Overland now taking over the media portion of the program. I want to welcome her into the fold, as well as the studio. She's sitting 4 feet from me. Anyone is welcome to post questions there, actually, on our Facebook page, Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. This one from Tom Jackson Jr. What was it like writing original songs for films like Lonely Christmas, Ron Howard's Grinch, movie with Jim Carrey, Wandering for 100 Girls? We just answered that one. Another fan question, this one from...
I can tell him one thing, though.
Okay, please.
Because the Ron Howard movie, the Grinch, was they were real secretive about what the movie was, and I didn't know it was a Ron Howard movie or anything. All I knew was it was a comedy, and the rumor was that Jim Carrey was in it, and it was Christmas. So I wrote a song. The chorus went, Santa, he's a big fat fuck. Crawled down the chimney, got his fat ass stuck. And I liked this song. And I turned it in, and the musical director was not happy with me at all. Then they came by with like a security guard and a videotape, and they were and watched me play it so I could see the scene to see what the movie was, and then they physically were there to see it and take the tape out of my hands and leave with it so that I would not spill the beans to the Russians.
Sure. And it was obviously the Russians, not the communist Chinese that we were concerned about.
No, they were concerned about the Russians.
Yeah.
And I just then I knew that what I'd written was really grossly inappropriate for children.
Yeah. Why not give a guy a heads up sooner?
Yeah. So there, I gave him a bit about that one.
I like that a lot. Little behind the scenes.
Yeah. Hey.
Oh, here we go. This one I asked earlier, started to tease earlier. Now we'll have it come directly from the Twitterverse at Red Door _ L Street. Can you tell us any more about your upcoming role on Community?
Hmm. Yeah, I'm a botanist.
Enough said. how did this come about?
I do the TV show, The Sing Off, on NBC.
Mm-hmm.
And some people were, they're both, I guess, on NBC.
Yeah.
So they tossed me on that to, I guess, cross-pollinate for some synergy.
Were you playing yourself?
No, I'm a botanist.
Botanist. This is an acting role. So, how do you? Sorry, I assume photography, botanist. It's all the same. So you just get pages and say, figure out what kind of character you want to play the botanist as?
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't really, there was no S at the end of page for this. It was more like just, it's a little line. It's very silly. It's really fun.
Oh,
I enjoyed it. I mean, my person, Alicia, is an actor, and she's done this since she was 7 years old.
Right.
And she held my hand through it, my acting coach.
Right.
Told me.
She did, he did well?
He's a fantastic actor.
You're a natural, she
Seriously.
Says. Yeah. What the hell?
She didn't accuse you of
Neil. It wasn't just one line, by the way.
Of course not. Of course it was more than one line.
I did some running.
Did you?
I think it's fun. No, I think it's really fun. It's really interesting. It's back to that same thing about doing stuff that's a little out of what you're comfortable with. And it makes you, I think focus for acting is really a bizarre place to me. Like, because one time you turn it on and you don't have it. Everything's on. It's like, I've never done this, so I don't know how to make that happen. The next time, for some mysterious reason, I seem to be in the room and it's okay. And then mannerisms occur and things happen and you're surprised by what you're saying.
Yeah.
But then the next time it comes on, it's like, okay, we're going to get that from another angle. And you're like, it's just gone.
I got to recreate the same exact.
So I found it really, really interesting. And the people on the show were really, really nice to me. And everyone held my hand through it. It was fun.
Did... you could have called up your pal Billy, and asked about doing every take differently.
Yeah,
the way that he insists on doing.
He does. Yeah, I think I did do things a little differently each time. Yeah,
you're fantastic. Every take was different.
And,
yeah,
and different. An editor's dream.
Yeah, yeah. I could not hope like that.
Yeah, I'm three or four takes, and I just feel myself acting.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard to stay in the groove.
Yeah, I'm like that about music. With the music, I find the first two or three takes really got something to them. I don't always admit that because there's some things I think I want to change or do better. Then it doesn't come back around until you've really passed the pain barrier at around 35 or 40.
Right.
But you can do 35 or 40 takes with no guilt because that's what the Rolling Stones did. You know, I mean, people have done that. Live bands go, all right, take 32, change a tape and do it. And sometimes things happen, but I don't think in a movie or a TV, I mean, you move too quickly. Like, there's no way you can't
unless it's Scorsese and De Niro, which I was fortunate to be a part of for a couple of scenes in the movie Casino, and they do 35 takes together if they want.
That's very rock.
And if you're in the scene with them, you're just watching.
Wow.
And then I remember, oh, I have a line. But otherwise, I'm just watching.
Is that distracting in a way? Or do you think that's actually helpful that you're watching?
No, it's definitely distracting. I should be in the scene. Yeah.
But this is the thing I don't understand about acting yet. Actually, if you're a person and you weren't acting,
right,
you would be watching. Like, you know, you wouldn't be aware that you're acting, so there must be some value in that.
Well, it's about listening always. So, yes, mm-hmm. If you're listening, then you're in the scene.
Right.
As opposed to thinking what I say next.
Oh, that's horrible. Didn't she taught me not to do that?
Thinking about what you're going to say next?
Yeah, not to do that.
But you know, I'm not proud of it, but I never had formal training. I was sort of self-taught, but it came from also being on stage as a.
How would you feel about taking an acting class? Have you ever done that since then? Like, if someone said, "Hey, this would be really funny, take it." Do you think that would mess you up?
Well, you know, it's interesting. First of all, I hated school, so the idea of listening to a teacher who's not acting, I would get a little subversive, I think, and undermining the authority figure, which is my natural go-to.
I can only imagine.
It also has to do with a fear of rejection and a fear of failure and a fear of a teacher who does know technique telling me I'm not doing it right. But Avalon, Barry Levinson's movie, was the first drama I did. And he was a comedian. Him and Craig T. Nelson were a comedy team in the coffee houses of the 60s. And so when I got I had a screen test. It was a big deal. But when I got the part, my then manager said, I know you're nervous about this, Kevin. He also represented Paul Reiser. And he said Paul worked with this acting coach when he did the movie Aliens because he was nervous about the dramatic acting in that. So if you want, I said, great, yeah, please. I was ready. So I went to Barry Levinson and I said, can I give a copy of the script to this acting coach that my manager wants me to work with? And this was after I was hired. And Barry said, oh, no, you're the guy. You're the guy that I hired because you were the guy in the scene. Just be the guy.
Right.
I don't want someone telling you what you should be doing, what you should be feeling, and what you should be saying, or how you should be saying it. You're the guy. That's why I hired you.
Hmm.
And I thought, oh, so there's no real talent involved in this. I'm just the guy. There's no technique needed. Just always be the guy.
Yeah.
That's the problem. That's the rub, is how to figure out how to be the guy every time.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's something about the phenom, the natural, who doesn't know to get in their own way.
Right.
And they always are out of their own mind. It's almost the ignorance is bliss.
Well, I mean, with the music, the idea is to spend so much time on your technique, have so much practice, that you're done with that. You're just there.
You can improvise.
And then you can improvise, you can play. I don't know the piano's there. This is how I feel at this moment. And I don't not like that all the time, but the times that I am like that, it's amazing. But the thing about acting, I think, what I noticed just doing it once is anyone could do it. You don't have to learn, like, you can't just, or anyone can't just sit down and play piano. You have to spend the time to do it. But you could pull some dude off the street,
yep,
and have him be an actor. And I
it's
think
called reality TV.
Well, that's right. Yeah. And actually, there's something really attractive about that. But I still, to me, like, technique and working through the technique and getting to the finer nuance of it. That is still like that.
Well, that was the thing I meant earlier, actually. I don't think it came out right about the chaos. What I meant to say was, I'm hearing control,
mm-hmm,
by the artist and from that chaos.
Right.
I'm not necessarily hearing stream of consciousness.
Right.
It's like a comfort zone for you.
Chaos.
Yeah.
It's a dynamic.
Right.
You know, because if you the dynamic difference between chaos and absolute order of just the right one note, really quiet. Because a lot of people think of me as being a real basher piano player, which is something that I can certainly do. But when I think about at least my favorite music, or just most of my music, it's actually fairly quiet playing. But it has the dynamic of coming out of something really big and you thunder. And then when the thunder's over, then you hear a little thing.
Quiet,
you hear a little thing, and then you hear the thunder. The thunder's scarier, so it's just dynamics.
Yeah. Speaking of the nuances and the subtlety, Bitches and Hoes.
Bitches and Hoes.
Yeah.
Both kinds.
Mm-hmm.
Bitches ain't shit.
Bitches ain't shit.
Oh, I thought they get it slightly wrong.
Yeah, that's what I do. I'm Homer Simpson, literally.
I like that.
What is the genesis of that?
We had a deadline for English B-sides. The English UK company at the time needed 4 exclusive B-sides for every song that we put out. So you've done an album, you have your outtakes and all stuff, and then they're like, we need 4. And I was thinking about how I really thought that Public Enemy's music was, or lyrics, would be so interesting put to music. Like, the topics and the way, it's like, you know, I can't do nothing for you, man. Like, these songs are just so, they had such, like Bob Dylan or something. These were really well-written songs. And so I sat down that day to do that very song, the Public Enemy, and they were so iambic pentameter-y that, that I wasn't able to find anything in it. So I played around with it for a while, and then I thought, okay, what am I going to do? I love the Chronic. Chronic's great. So the first one that popped in my head was the most disgusting one, which is Bitches Ain't Shit. It's a foul, horrible song. Actually, it's a great song, but it's like really horrible.
The lyrics are certainly.
Yeah, I took out a lot of them, actually, because it would have been really, really long. And I just was thinking, you know, like, this needs to be just really pretty, because people listen to the gangster saying this, and they're desensitized by it. But if you put a pretty melody to it, and little white guy sings it like he really means it, then you're going to really hear these words. You're really going to hear these words. And it was actually really uncomfortable. Now, I talk about it kind of with some weight and seriousness, because I took it seriously when we did it. I mean, I knew that people would think it was funny, but I was also really, that take is like, it's a special take. And everything was just mic'd with one mic. It's basically a mono recording. We did it in like one pass, and it had a vibe. And one of my favorite recordings that I've done, because it was done so quickly, and then of course it came out, and it was its own kind of hit. I mean, I've had a few hits. I've had Brick, that's a hit. this Bitches Ain't Shit, that's a hit. I mean, that changed my audiences. Suddenly I was playing to bigger audiences because of a song that never was even released, you know, like officially, just right. downloaded. And then this chat roulette thing that I did was a hit mm-hmm. for me. And it was just, I was just joking around and played with, you know, people would be on the screen and I played songs to them and the audience, there's, you know, 3,000 people in the audience looking at some guy who's jerking off in his bathroom and I'm playing a song for him.
Yeah.
It's another hit.
Well, of course it is. Don't say it like it's a mistake or an accident.
Yeah.
I mean, that's by design.
It is by design.
I'm being told you have a plane to catch. Where are you headed?
I'm
Not
going
that
to,
it's my business.
And I'm going to Nashville to finish my piano concerto.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah, we start playing, doing read-throughs with the symphony orchestra, and I'm going to be doing it.
You started playing with symphony orchestras a while back.
Yeah, about 8 years ago I started doing it. It's maybe a third of my shows or every year I've been with orchestras, except for last year, which was Benfold 5, but usually it's with orchestras.
It must just feel like you're floating on a different kind of cloud.
Well, it's like you're fighting with a really big elephant, too, because they're spread out across a lot of real estate, and their heads in the music and their heads on the conductor, eyes on the conductor, and from the piano player's point of view, it's the worst seat in the house. It sounds terrible, but it does feel incredibly powerful, but you can't hear a note. I don't hear shit. It's like I'm playing.
You don't have the things?
I keep my monitors really low because the string players can't tune when they're up high, and you're just in this place, and I'm used to hearing, you know, this guy started with a stacks of amplifiers I like, but I've got quiet, and then they're all kind of like, the percussionist is playing like a year later because it's just so far away, it doesn't groove at all, but it sounds awesome out front, and it feels good, but I just have to go, is this working? This must be working, and I'm leading the conductor's leading the orchestra, and they're reading off the music that I can't read because I can't read music. So,
I'm sorry. It sounded like you said you can't read music.
Yeah.
Okay. Just wanted to.
Yeah, that's right. I can tell what it means. I can't make my fingers do what I'm seeing on the page.
Because you don't want to.
Well, I tried. I did try. You know, and I. This might be a half. This is a half-ass excuse, and it may not be right. But I mean, there's a lot of dyslexic people in my family, and my father, and his brother, and my brother, and just there's so many of them, and I read fine. You know, can do that. I can read and write fine, but piano, it's like I look at it, you know, like the staff, it turns upside down. I don't know where it is. I can't keep my head in it. I don't know what I'm doing. It doesn't mean anything to me, and it just looks like gobbledygook. So
that's kind of fantastic and perfect.
I can't read it. I can write the shit out of it.
Yeah.
I can sit down and write it out on staff paper and hand it to
someone who can read it.
And then they read it and everyone's happy, but I can't read it.
That's wild that you're playing with this unwielding elephant on stage and you can't hear them.
Yeah, you're like,
This leads me to a horrible question. Is there any chance that you think you're writing music and other people are just being kind?
They go, oh yeah, that's good. Like, yeah, that's what I did. Okay. That's good. Because they heard me playing it while I was writing it down. They're being nice to me.
Yeah, the finished product is fine. Just let him do whatever he wants.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with the Emperor's clothing.
That's right. Yeah. No, I would surround myself with yes men on every level, and they just do it. You know? Don't question.
Well, I can't thank you enough, honestly, for making time for us. By the time you land in Nashville, I will have the screenplay of the next film I'm directing. I think it is time for you to compose.
Yeah, I'd love to do that.
For a very specific genre. Well, you'll see it when you read it. We had, well, the hell with them. The hell with those other.
Here, where? I'll play you. I'm probably not supposed to. I'll play you two bars into my thing of the.
Please.
Of the concerto as it stands.
Probably not supposed to.
I don't think so. Hey, this won't be recordable though. I don't know why it's not playing. This is technology is going on. I'm not doing that. Get your ass sued. Okay. Huh. But it's supposed to play.
Somebody wake up Steve Jobs. We've got a problem.
Is Siri a lawyer now? What the hell?
I know.
What a bitch.
Well, boy, all that for...
we love, never we love not the played. Intent. We love the effort.
You know what? We'll add it in post.
Oh. That's all.
Wow.
That was sweet. Quite the tease.
Yeah.
That was fantastic.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Please be seated, everyone. They jumped to their feet. Now, we closed the show with something that I did not give you a heads up about before. So this will be a challenge to your improvisational skills. Okay. It's called the Larry King Game.
Okay.
And it came about, our very own Jamie Foxx created it. It came about because we loved the bumpers that Larry would do right before he would go to the phones, people calling in. He would look into the camera and share something about himself mm-hmm. that no one needed to know.
Okay.
So what I asked the guests to do is a Larry King moment.
Okay.
So it's a bad Larry King impression. I don't want a good one.
Okay.
Because there's nothing funny about a good Larry King impression. So it could sound like anything.
Okay.
And then as Larry, you'll share something about Larry that no one needs to know. And then you'll go to the phones, and if the name of the city is funny sounding, it's helpful. So it's just, let your camera there, looking into camera as Larry, sharing something about Larry.
I share something first, and then I have a question.
And then you go to the phone and just name the city that you're going to. Like,
oh, okay.
Give him the prototype.
Oh, the prototype.
Yeah.
Thanksgiving, I like to teabag the gravy boats before the guests arrive. Schenectady, hello.
Wow, okay.
So that's what he chose to share in that moment. And now, anything at all that comes to mind, actually.
Okay.
As Larry. Yeah, just zip it away.
Well, this is Larry King, and I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about. I can't really improvise at all, and I've got maggots in my scrotum. Truth of Consequences, New Mexico.
Love it, yes! Nice! Also a film directed by Kiefer Sutherland that I co-star in, but you didn't know that. It's Truth or Consequences,
oh, really?
New Mexico.
Oh,
yeah.
Awesome.
And we all said when we got to set, that's not a real name of the city, is it? And sure enough, it is.
It is.
Thank you so very much, honestly. Sit there uncomfortably for 90 seconds while I wrap things up for the folks at home. I do want to welcome Danielle Overland, our new media maven for the show, and bid a fond yet sad farewell to Elaine Ewing, who did right by us for 4.5 years. We couldn't be happier for her in greener pastures. Dr. Chen, Jamie and Sammy here in the studio, and Josh and J-Mac outside. And Ryan Eaton helping out a little bit today, and our own Samantha Ward coming back to slap on some powder on these glistening faces of ours. Not sure who the guest is next week. Look for